Ephesians 4, 1 to 6. Alam ko na yung iba sa inyo yung dinadownload nyo yung Bible sa cellphones ninyo. But if you don't have Bibles, pwede rin kayong humiram sa RBM. I think may mga, nalagay ko may mga Bibles din sila dito dahil 3,000 na dito. You'll be needing your Bibles. But for tonight's Lectio Divina, baka i-reproduce na natin yung the text of the Gospel na gagamitin for the sharing this evening. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let's put ourselves in the presence of God and beg the Spirit to guide us as we begin this day. From the letter of Paul to the Ephesians. I then, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to live in a manner worthy of the call you have received, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another through love, striving to preserve the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace, one body and one Spirit, as you were also called to the one hope of your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all, and through all, and in all. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So na-introduce ko na yung general topic na natin kagabi with the sacramental priesthood in sacramental brotherhood. And for our first session today, I'd like to invite you to reflect on living the sacramental priesthood as acting in the person of Christ who builds the church. Ulit-ulit yung maririnig yun, that we act in the person of Christ, because our ministry is really about being sacraments of Christ, the sacraments of the priesthood of Christ. I hope hindi kayo nabigla nung sabihin kong hindi tayo ang pare, kung hindi tayo si Kristo lang ang pare at tayo sakramento ng pagkapare ni Kristo. So we live the sacramental priesthood by acting in persona Christi. Hindi madali to act in the person of Christ, to represent Christ. Bakit? Anong karapatan natin to represent Christ? But He chose us. Hindi natin siya pinili, pinili niya tayo. And we allow Him to continue building His church. We don't build the church. Christ was. And we participate in the ongoing edification of the church. And the first sign of the work of Christ is unity. We build the church in unity. One holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We start today with the one church. The church in unity. From the very start, Jesus did everything He could to keep His community together. Pagkatapos ng pagkakapako niya sa krus, ay muntik na silang magkawatak-watak. And I can imagine kung bakit. Dahil sino ba sa kanila ang nanatili sa paano ng cruz? Wala. Mga babae lang. Well, depende kung anong ebanghelyo binabasa mo. Kung binabasa mo ang Synoptic Gospels, puro babae yung naiwan sa paano ng cruz. Kung binabasa mo yung Gospel of John, merong natira sa paano ng cruz. Sino? Sino may akda? John din. Kaya medyo ingat ako ng konti dyan eh. At hindi niya mabanggit ang pangalan niya, kaya ang tawag niya dun sa alagad na yon ay the beloved disciple. The beloved disciple. I'm honestly more inclined to believe that not a single one of them stayed at the foot of the cross. Mga takot po na, they all ran away. And that is why I wouldn't be surprised if after the crucifixion, they found it difficult to regroup. Because may tendency na silang to blame each other. Magsumbata. Pasumpa-sumpa ka pa dyan. Nahanda kang ibuwis ang buhay mo para sa kanya. Pedro, nasaan ka? Kung sandaling ipako siya sa cruz. Palagay ko nagsumbatan sila. Kaya hindi na nila matiis ang isa't isa. Kaya nga tumakas yung dalawa eh. May dalawang tumakas mula doon sa upper room papuntang bayan ng Emmaus. Hindi naman sila naglakbay, tumatakas sila. Hindi sila naglalakad sa ilalim ng maliwanag na buwan. Sila'y tumatakas. Iniwan nila ang mga kasamahan. Wala nang pag-asa. They have given up hope. They have given up on each other. Kaya, nakipagpatintero pa si Jesus sa kanila. Jesus intercepted them, but they failed to recognize him. Luke 24, the news story. Jesus had to walk with them. Jesus had to debrief them. They were in a state of trauma. He made them tell what happened. And they told it as a tragic story. And Jesus carefully listened to their tragic story. Akala pa naman namin, siya na ang tutor sa bayan. And Jesus patiently listened to their story. But after listening to their story, Jesus retold their story in a different light, in the light of scriptures. He interpreted to them, not the scriptures, he interpreted to them their experience in Jerusalem in the light of the scriptures. And of course, they would say later on their hearts were burning inside them. And after breaking bread, and after being able to recognize him finally through the breaking of the bread, aba, nakalimutan nilang takot nila. Their fear is transformed into courage. They run back to the very place they're running away from. Their sadness is transformed into joy. They are excitedly seeking out their brothers. Because they have a good news to tell. Natagpuan namin siya, nakasama namin siya, nakita namin siya. The net effect is a return. Just when they were going to run away from the community, they found themselves returning to the community. Ito ang gawain ng muling nabuhay. Inararanas niya sa kanila ang muling pagkabuhay. Ganyan din ang ginawa kay Tomas. Ang tao ko kay Tomas, the walk-out king. Tomas was not with them when Jesus appeared to them. Sa palagay niyo pa, bakit wala si Tomas doon? Ang suspensya ko, nagkatampuhan. Nangyayari sa atin yan, di ba? Nung bigla na lang, hindi na nagsishow up sa recollection o sa retreat. Ibig sabihin niyo. Nangyayari din sa atin yan. Hindi natin alam kung bakit. Basta na lang wala si Tomas. Dati-rati, andun siya. Kasama nila. Ngayon, wala. He was not with them. And if you are not with them, you will not be able to share in their common experience. When you become miserable, pinagtampuhan niya yung komunidad. Parang bata. Hindi ko kayo batik. Hindi ko kayo kausap. Parang bata nagtampo. Alam niyo ba yung feeling ng taong nagtatampo tapos wala mo nakakapansin? Mas masakit yun eh. Kaya ako nga tumahimik at humiwalay at hindi na nagsasalita, hindi na sumasama. Para mapansin ka. Mas masakit ni hindi ka napansin yan. Ah, wala ba siya? Parang who cares? Mas masakit yun. Parang ganun ang naramdaman ni Tomas. Kasi, nagtampo siya, umalis siya, at bumalik din naman siyang pusa. Siguro nagugutom na, kaya bumalik. Bumalik ng pusa, at pagbalik niya, kinakausap naman siya. We have seen the Lord. And excited sila. Kasi sa kanilang wala naman silang tampo. Siyang may tampo eh. We have seen the Lord, ang sabi sa kanya. Sabi niya, unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and on his side, I will not believe. Kung kanino yung kanyang I will not believe, tungkol kay Kristo? Hindi. Tungkol sa mga kasama niya. He's not saying, I will not believe the Lord. He's saying, I will not believe you. I've lost trust in you. I don't believe in you anymore. This is about a broken relationship. The Lord had to deal with the humanity of His community. Pinapasok din sila ng ganito. Mga intriga, mga tampuhan. Kaya, nung nagpakita ang Panginoon sa kanya, ang unang itahaplos niya ay sugat, halika, haplosin mo aking mga sugat. And then just my Lord and my God. Parang ang mensahe ng Panginoon kay Tomas ay, Tomas, bumalik ka na. Sarili mong sinusugatan mo kapag humihiwalay ka. Huwag kang hihiwalay. And Peter was also like that. I'm going to ask you to meditate on that this evening. Peter by the Sea of Tiberias. I think it's even worse with Peter. He's not giving up on the community. He's giving up on himself. Hindi masyado nakabawi yung tao to. Wala na siyang mukhang haharap sa Panginoon. Sumumpa-sumpa na siya. Tapos yun, nung nagkatatangan, itinatwa ang Panginoon. At wala man siya nung sandaling yun. Sisilip-silip mula sa malayo. Ang tapang niya, ang lakas ng loob, pero nung kumprontahin siya ng isang katulong na babae, nervous niya, tinatwa niya ang Panginoon. ay hindi niya mapatawad ang sarili niya. Mas masakit yun. Mas masakit doon sa gumibak ka sa kasamahan mo. May mas masakit pa doon ang gumibak ka sa sarili mo. Kaya nung nagpakita ang Panginoon, hindi siya excited. It is the Lord, ang sabi ng beloved disciple. Anong ginawa niya? Lumundag sa tubig. Gustong itago ang pagmumukha niya. Hindi siya. Parang pag-uulit ng live before, kaya mas sinful man. Lumayo ka, Panginoon. Hindi ako karapat-dapat. I'm not your man. Duwag ako. Mahinga lang ako. Pero, the Lord did not give up on him. And then, later on, he was being fed like a lamb. You know, that story is not about the resurrection of Jesus. It's about the resurrection of Peter. Siya ang binubuhay na muli ng Panginoon. And so you see, from the very start, we were threatened. Threatened. The community was threatened by splitting up. Pagkakawata. Nanganganib na magkawata ang sambayanan ng Kristo. In 2007, I remember, I was invited by the United Church of Christ to the Philippines in their National Conference of Bishops. Nakapagyaroon din pala silang National Conference of Bishops. UCCP, Mainstream Philippine Protestants. Alam niyo ang topic? They asked me to speak to them about unity. Unity daw. Ang sabi ko, may context ko ito. Meron daw. The context was, they were trying to heal their splitting up. They were still trying to do their last-ditch effort to heal their divisions. Sabi ko, what is causing it? Ang sabi nila, election of bishops. Ini-elect pala din yung bishops nila. At dahil ini-elect ang bishops nila, nangangampan niya. Alam nila sino ang Pilato, nangangampan niya. Nang hahalal sa kanila. Each one would organize his own group of loyalists. At kapag natalo, those who lose and are sore losers, leave the church. And organize their own loyalists and put up their own church. Kawawa naman. It's the same problem happening with our brothers and sisters in the INC. Their symbol of unity had died. And that symbol was for a long time, Eranio, Erbi, who kept the vision of Felix. Akala nila, ganun lang kadali yun, that the son would succeed. But he had many sons, Eranio, and one of them is Eduardo. He's supposed to have been succeeded by Eduardo, but Eduardo is at odds with Angel, and all the others, including the mother. And now, Eduardo is asking a good modern question. My brother, Randy David, being a sociologist, you know, said, actually, they're asking a modern question. Should the Iglesia ni Cristo remain as a family corporation? For a long time, it was being kept by a family. And this family is trying to be loyal to the vision of their patriarch. But, somehow, if they are concerned about the sustainability of their church, it's important to institutionalize, to stabilize it. Kaya tama si Eduardo. Let us remove this from the family. I may be a Manalo, but what matters to me is that this church is not a Manalo business. But this church is an Iglesia ni Cristo business. It's still business. It should be run by a council, Sanggunian. Kaya Eduardo was torn between the Sanggunian and the Manalo family. But the Manalo family is insisting that the vision comes from their patriarch. That for as long as a member of the family remains as a benevolent leader, this church could be sustained. Eduardo did not seem to believe so. And he happened to be surrounded by people in the Sanggunian who had ulterior motives other than really sustaining their church. Because big business naman talaga ang racket ng black voting eh. Very lucrative. Yan ang pinagdadasal kung sana ma-expose na scam. And I was hoping yun talaga ang lumabas. Pero nahinto nila eh. Na parang napoles, may magkukwento. And then they will begin to squeal kung sino sa mga senador at congressmen ang nangagbayad ng boto. Ang nangagbayad upang mahalal sila makakuha ng black vote sa Iglesia ni Cristo. Business yan eh. That's the one big corruption that has not yet been exposed. It's waiting for a Benhard Louis, something like that. No? But you see, that is always the case when the purported founder dies. Kapag namatay ang founder, the group dies with the founder. Meron kaming ganyan sa compound eh. Ang Tariana. Ewan ko kung kilala ninyo ang Tariana. They call themselves a lay monastic community founded and led by an ex-Benedictine who is suspended, has no faculties but defies the church. So what? And he has declared Pope Francis as an anti-Christ and an anti-Pope. But he calls himself Catholic. He does not want any of his disciples to become a priest. So, parang sa kanya, ako lang ang leader. Nobody else. Okay. Tingnan natin anong mangyayari sa movement mo pagkamatay mo, pupulutin sa kampungan. That is why even the religious congregations, their founders made it clear that their real head is Christ. I think that's the only reason why we're kept in unity. Gaano man karaming diocese sa buong mundo, gaano man karaming religious congregations sa buong mundo, the first principle of unity is wala tayong ibang pinuno kundi si Kristo. And so, the common tendency for other sects or groups is when the founder dies, the group dies with them. Or they split up. They split up and split up and split up into small splinter groups. Not with the church if it is founded by Christ. It remains alive because Christ is alive. Yesterday, today, and forever. He is alive in every member of His body, the Church. He is alive in everyone, who is anointed to act in the person of the head. So we go into the principles of unity in the Church. I propose, well, four things. Number one, one body. Number two, one spirit. Number three, faith, hope, and charity. I won't use love. I'd rather use charity. And number four, kenosis, self-emptying. Dapat may number five pa, but I'll postpone it for tomorrow evening. Reconciliation. That's a principle of unity. One body. This is a big contribution of St. Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, also in Romans chapter 12, and several other texts in the Pauline letters. Unity is the prayer of Jesus in John chapter 17. You remember the farewell address of Jesus. May they be one, Father, as you and I are one. The Church is called to live out the unity of the Trinity. We are supposed to reflect the unity of our God, the Trinity, the communion of persons. The unity of God is not about pag-iisa kundi pagkakaisa. In the Old Testament, we have a little story about negative unity. And what I call negative unity is the unity of the builders of the Tower of Babel. Not all unity is possible. Because sometimes people can unite themselves around an evil purpose. And that kind of unity has to be destroyed. That's why sometimes we get scandalized when we hear Jesus say, I have come to bring not peace, but division. Their division is not negative. So negative unity is when people are united around something wrong. Many years ago, I remember watching television and a rapist was being interviewed by a media personality. Tinanong nung taga-media yung rapist, bakit mo naman ginawang karuman-ruman na bagay ngayon? Kasi bukod sa nirape yung bata, pinatay pa, pinagpukupok ang ulo. Sagot ba naman ng rapist, pakikisama lang po. Nakikisama lang daw siya. Kanino? Kabarkada. Kasi nagkasundo sila. To do that. See, we were united. That's unity. But the wrong unity. That kind of unity has to be split up. It's the unity of the Tower of Babel. The unity of people who play God, who want to build a tower or a tower to their ego. Well, the opposite of Babel is the positive unity of Pentecost. And Pentecost tells us that each one was speaking in his own language, but they could understand each other. Pentecost is not about speaking one language. It's about speaking many languages and being able to understand each other. Because they listen. Sometimes people speak the same language already and could not understand each other. So the positive unity is the unity of Pentecost. Now, St. Paul introduces the unity using the analogy of the body in 1 Corinthians 12 because he is addressing an issue with the Corinthian community, factionalism, division, pagkakawatak-watak. Nagpapaligsahan na sila pag-alipag-alingan. Let's listen to St. Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Yung sabi niya, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree in what you say, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind and the same purpose. Because it has been reported to me about you, brothers, by Chloe's people, that there are rivalries among you. I mean that each of you is saying, I belong to Paul, or I belong to Apollos, or I belong to Cephas, or I belong to Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? So, you see, Paul introduces the analogy of the body to introduce the mystery of the church, the church's unity. Like a body with many parts, he says, so it is with Christ. That is now going to be in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Chapter 12, sorry. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. As a body is one, though it has many parts, and all the parts of the body, though many, are one body, so also Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all given to drink of the one Spirit. Now the body is not a single part, but many. Pwede daw ang sabihin ng paa dahil hindi siya kamay, eh wala siyang kinalaman sa katawan? O pwede bang sabihin ng isang tenga na dahil hindi siya mata, wala siyang kinalaman sa katawan? At nakakita ka na ba ng isang katawan na puro mata? E kung puro mata, paano siya makakarinig? But as it is, ang sabi niya, God placed the parts, each one of them in the body as He intended. If they were all just one part, where would the body be? So he's speaking about one body, many parts. But the parts are coordinated. They act in a coordinated way. Because they're united or God. So the body is our metaphor for unity. May kasabihan sa Tagalog, ang sakit ng kalikingan ay ramdam ng katawan, ng buong katawan. Totoo ba yun? Depende kung malusog ang katawan. So pwede mangyari na mamanhid ang mga bahagi ng katawan dahil may sakit. At kapag may sakit o hindi malusog o manhid, may kahit hampasin mo pa yung paa, hindi mararamdaman ang katawan. May problema. Kaya isa sa mga magandang palatandaan na malusog pa rin ang katawan ay kapag nasasaktan. Kapag nararamdaman pa rin, ng katawan ang sakit ng kalikitan. Kapag hindi maramdaman ng katawan ang sakit ng kanyang mga bahagi, may problema ang katawan na yun. Na mahalaga ang sakit. So we are one body. We're supposed to understand our unity in the body of Christ. Organically, that we're related to each other. And that is expressed in the many charisms of the different parts of the body. The many different gifts that they receive. Kasi iba-iba ang ginagawa ng bawat bahagi. Pero ang katawan, iisa. Iba ang ginagawa ng mata, sa ilong, sa tenga, sa bibig, at iba pang mga bahagi ng katawan. Pero, nagkakaisa. Bakit? Dahil sa iisang Espiritu. One body, one spirit. Different gifts, one spirit. Kung ang ating mga kaloob na tinanggap ang maging dahilan ng ating pagkakawata-wata, yun marahil ay unang palatandaan na hindi iisang Espiritu ang gumagalaw. Kung iisang Espiritu ang pinagmulan ng ating mga kaloob, hindi sila magiging dahilan ng pagkakawata-wata. And so, Paul would say, we talk about the many different gifts. Yung sabi niya, now you are Christ's body and individually parts of it. Some have been designated to be apostles, others prophets, others teachers, others performers of mighty deeds. There are those with the gifts of healing, the gift of assistance, the gift of management, administration. And there are those who are bestowed with the gifts of tongues. Are all expected to be apostles? Are all expected to be prophets or teachers or workers of mighty deeds? Are all expected to have gifts of healing or the gifts of tongues? Are all expected to be interpreters? So the question is important. It matters, you know, that the gifts do not get into conflict with each other because they come from the same Spirit. He says this also in what we read in Ephesians. Grace was given to each of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, it says, He ascended on high and gave gifts to men. But what does He ascended mean, except that He also descended into the lower regions of the earth? And He gave some as apostles, others as prophets, others as evangelists, others as pastors, and others as teachers, to equip the holy ones for the work of the ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of faith and knowledge of the Son of God, to the mature manhood, to the extent of the full stature of Christ. We receive the same Spirit so that we can grow into Christ. Our calling is not just to be Christians, but to be Christ. And madala kong sabihin, if we want to evangelize, don't talk about Christ, be Christ. Don't speak about Christ. No, let Christ speak through you. Why? Because you are a part of Christ by virtue of the gift of baptism. Baptism, you know, is not about receiving Christ. It's about becoming part of Christ. Kaya ako inis na inis sa mga born again, sasabing, have you received Jesus? Di ba yung mga panong yung mga Pentecostals? Have you accepted Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior? Have you put Jesus in your heart? Yung tipong pwede, ano nila, parang napaka-arrogant na question, ang wala si Kristo sa iyo. Then sagot ko dyan eh, I think something's wrong with your understanding of baptism. Because baptism isn't about accepting Jesus. It's about being accepted by Jesus. It's the other way around. Baptism is about making Jesus a part of my self. It's not about putting Jesus in my heart. It's the other way around. It's me becoming part of Jesus, part of His body. Sabi nila, pwede mo daw i-determine yung DNA structure ng buong katawan on the basis of one cell. Ganyan din ang katawan ni Christ. Each one of us contains the full DNA of Christ. If we have been baptized, grafted into the body of Christ. Now that's made possible by the Spirit that brings together the body into one. One Spirit. One Spirit. Different gifts, one Spirit. But you know, in spite of Paul's constant advocacy of unity through the image of the one body and the one Spirit, may division pa rin sa Corinthian community. And so, he taught them further principles of unity. Ang sabi niya, let us aspire for the greater gifts. Yun ang ending ng 1 Corinthians 12. Baka tumanggap tayo ng lesser gifts only, but not the greater gifts. And so, he says in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, I shall now teach you a more excellent way. Meaning, to aspire for the greater gifts. And those greater gifts he would identify in 1 Corinthians 13, verse 13. So faith, hope, and love, these are the greater gifts. But the great test of these is love. Hindi ako masyadong komportable sa word love dito. It's so unfortunate na pag binasa mo yung English Bible, ang daming mga salita sa Griego na pag tinranslate yung isang translation, love. Ang philia, love. Ang eros, love. Ang agape, love. Ano ba yan? Parang wala nang distinction. Very fine distinction in the Greek language. And we lose the nuances the moment we translate them all into love. But Paul is speaking here about agape, which is a different thing altogether from friendship, from a reciprocal love. Kasi totoo naman madaling magmahal sa mga taong kaibig-ibig. Madaling mahalin yung taong nagmamahal sa'yo. That's the common understanding of love. Reciprocity. Mutuality. But this is not the love that Jesus is talking about. In this consists God's love, that while we were yet sinners, He died for us. There was no reciprocity. That the agape that we're talking about, which is translated as love in 1 Corinthians 13, is about unconditional love. That you are able to love even when not reciprocated. Love your enemy. Do good to those who hate you. And pray even for those who persecute you. The love that makes it possible for you to be forgiven. Do not judge and you will not be judged. Do not condemn and you will not be condemned. Forgive and you will be forgiven. Give and you will receive. Good measure, shaken together, running over. For the measure with which you measure will be measured out to you. the principle of love. It's about unconditionality. It's the third important principle for Paul of keeping the body of Christ together. That the greatest is not faith. The greatest gift is not even hope. Kaya hindi tayo dapat mabahala kapag may nawawala ng pananampalataya. You may lose your faith for all I care. Just don't lose love. Just don't lose charity. Charity is the old translation for agape to distinguish it from reciprocal love. Unfortunately, charity has degenerated into a token barrier for the poor. No, charity is the capacity to give without condition. So it's not faith. It's not even hope. It is love. Love is the basis. It's charity. It is the fertile soil on which the seed of God's word can grow.